All right. So, to start, you guys have a problem set due this Friday. Like we said last week, you either have to turn in digitally by 5 o'clock on the Moodle, or if you want to turn in a physical copy, you can submit it during Juno's office hours, which take place, whatever it says on here, I think 1 to 2 on Friday. Yes. So you can either turn in a physical copy to him between 1 and 2 p.m. on Friday, or you can wait until 5 o'clock, just so you have to submit it digitally to do that. So other than the logistical side, do people have questions they would like me to go over related to that homework assignment?
Can you bring it up real quick, actually? I was confused about the wording on probably good one.
Okay.
What does it mean by overlapping I.O. with CPU processing? Is it talking about polling versus interrupt or DMA?
So the way I mean, all of those things could be examples of this. It's kind of a wide open question of what kind of situations or what kind of systems exist to allow us to overlap I.O. and CPU processing.
Okay.
So the gist of it is, why are do our when we have a system that's performing I.O. requests if there's multiple processes, why is the total amount of time to execute less than what you would expect if you just had to wait for that I.O. request, right?
Okay.
You can go off and do other useful work.
Right.
There's different ways of doing that, and the question just says, give me a couple of examples of different ways of doing that and kind of explain the ideas there are.
Okay.
Other questions?
The second half of 2 asks when would a time sharing system be faster in the execution of all programs than a batch system?
Okay. So the way I would answer that question kind of relates to the question he just asked too. In most batch systems, when you hit an I.O. request, you're stuck. You just have to wait for it. I mean, if you have to go write 100 files to tape, it's going to take forever, and you just have to wait on it. Whereas in a round-robin system, you could go do useful work on another process. So you would expect a round-robin system to be faster in that case, especially in the case where you have a lot of I.O.-heavy processes, because they can go and start dealing with the other processes while the I.O. is still going on one of them. Whereas in a batch system, you start the I.O., you have to wait for it to end. It's literally, you got to wait that total amount of time before you go to another process. There might be some other answers too, but that's kind of the one I would go with first. Are there?
Can you recommend any good plotting programs for doing the time sequence diagrams? I used GNUplot. I kind of had to hack it to get me what I wanted.
So I don't spend enough of my life drawing the plotting diagrams, but I figured out a clever tool chain way of doing it. I mean, when I just need to draw stuff anymore, I either using Scape or just Google Docs drawing. I just need to slap something together quickly. But as far as ways to like formally give it an input file where you give it start and end points and have it magically generate a draft, I don't know. There's probably a LaTeX plugin. But short of that, I've never had to do that, so I don't know how to do it. Are there other questions?
And end of part one, asking about, we're assuming here that if a process finishes early, it's returning control of the scheduler in the kernel.
I'm sorry, say it again, process finishes what?
No, part one, wasn't it? At the end of part one, I was asking, or I was mentioning, assume that a process finishes early, that it transfers control back to the OS scheduler.
Right.
Are we assuming that scheduling is the same amount of time that it takes to do a context switch? So do you
the switching time, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's basically saying in a round robin system,
yeah,
if you are inside your time step, right, you finish without using
before
all that
time, right,
go on, just continue immediately. Don't wait for that time step to end before you continue.
Right.
But it would still have the same switching time you would expect at the end of that time.
Okay. So we're not assuming any. We're kind of ignoring the overhead of the actual scheduler, choosing what process to do next, since we're assuming around 11.
Yeah, right. That gets built
constant
up.
Constant times right. For that sort of.
You assume schedule. That the overhead of picking and all of that is kind
okay.
of built. I mean, yeah, around robin doesn't really have any overhead. Of
right.
It's stupid about it, right? Okay. Other questions? Okay. Close the door. So, your next assignment, last chance before we go on. Okay? Again, due Friday at 5 o'clock. If you're gonna turn in a physical copy, due Friday by 2 o'clock at Juno's office hours in the CSUN. So let's start talking about your next assignment. So your next assignment is essentially gonna be a threaded programming assignment, is the gist of it. It's learning how to program in a threaded environment, as well as how you have to handle protection schemes with threading, so on and so forth. Today I'm gonna take you through a trivial implementation that's basically a non-threaded solution to the problem we're asking you to solve. We'll be providing this when we also provide the rest of our, when we provide the write-up for this lab and everything like that next week. The point is, I mean, we have a problem that you have to solve, but the point isn't to solve the problem, the point is to teach you threaded programming along the way. So we will give you a non-threaded version of this program that solves the same problem. Your goal is to write a threaded program that does the same thing. So the essential goal we're trying to solve, or the problem that we're doing for the purpose of this assignment, is a DNS lookup problem, where the way it more or less works is you start out with a file that has a series of domain names. So you start with one or more files with these domain names. The files are formatted such that they're just per line as per the spec of the program. It's kind of arbitrary, but you get a set of domain names as your input. You then, through the magic of programming, have some program that eventually, one way or another, translates these to a single output file that gives you both the domain name and the IP address that goes along with it. So your output file would look something like, and the format it specifies, again, it's kind of arbitrary, but follow the format is the domain name you looked up, followed by a comma, followed by at least one valid IP address for that domain name. So, I don't know. I don't actually have Google memorized. SOPA hasn't passed away. So you end up with an output that essentially looks like that. And the crux of the matter is how we do this translation. So the solution I'm going to take you through is essentially a single-threaded implementation, kind of a naive way where you would just get the mechanics out of the way of doing this translation. The way you guys will do it looks a little bit more like this. So mine looks a lot like this, single program. I mean, yours is still gonna be a single program, but yours deals with threading. So the naive solution, take your input, generate your output. We'll talk about that in a second. Kind of give you guys a preview, the way your solution looks is, to start, you have more than a single input file like this. You have some arbitrary number of input files, where each of these files has a list of domain names but essentially follows this format. You then dispatch one thread per input file, essentially. So you have a group of threads that goes off and processes each input file, where the job of these threads is pretty simply just to parse the input file, extract the domain names, and toss them into a big common queue. So essentially, you wind up with, it's implemented as a queue. I mean, you could re-implement it differently. But you end up with this big queue that is essentially all domain names you need to look up. So the first half is you have threads, one per process. They're just grabbing domain names out of those files. They're tossing them into this queue. That's just a big pile of domain names in need of being looked up. You then have a second set of threads over on this side whose job it is to grab domain names out of this pool and look them up, write the output to this file. So you then have your essentially output thread pool over here, where you have some arbitrary number of threads all writing to the same output file and all reading from this queue, like so. So it's a producer-consumer problem at some parts. You have a thread pool that is the producer, it's reading files, it's tossing data into a pool. You then have a consumer that's pulling data out of this pool, performing some operation on it, and writing an output to a file. So the cruxes of this are twofold. I mean, it's making these threads work in a nice and pretty way, but more importantly it is we have two shared resources here. The output file is singular, and our pool, the IP address we have to look up, our queue is singular. So these are essentially two resources that have to be gracefully shared by all of these threads. This one has to be shared by all threads, period, because it's both being written to and pulled from. This one you just have to worry about sharing it amongst your output threads. But the concept's the same. If you have one thread trying to read from this file and another's writing to it, you're going to foul something up. If you have multiple threads trying to write to your output file at the same time, you're going to foul something up. So it's a game of you have a couple of shared resources. You have to both thread the program and in doing so not screw up your shared resources. So you have to put in the correct protection schematics to ensure that nothing can read from this while something else is writing from it. No two things try to read from it simultaneously. No two things try to write to this simultaneously, so on and so forth. That's the real heart of this problem. That's the operating system side of it. And we'll touch on that a little bit after this. You're going to get the problem on Monday. It's going to be due 2 weeks from this Friday. So you'll essentially have a little bit less than 2 weeks, 2 weeks minus a weekend to work on it. We'll be talking about the naive solution today. And if we have some extra time, we'll maybe start to dive into some of the problems you have to think about in this kind of a solution. Next week, we'll be focusing more on the pitfalls of this kind of a solution. And it'll be open for questions. I would highly encourage you all to start on it. We'll release the code Monday. Get a start on it before recitation on Wednesday, if only so you can kind of show up with an idea of what you're dealing with, and hopefully help make this more enlightening or show up with questions. It's also not nearly as easy as your last assignment. It's way more open-ended. We give you a few things to try to make it a little bit easier, namely so you don't have to teach yourself Berkeley sockets to do it while you're at it. But you are going to have to teach yourself the pthread library if you haven't used it before. This is not a pthreads tutorial course. So you'll be using pthreads to do this. If you've never used pthreads before, you got some reading in your future. It's well documented, but you're going to have to learn it. And you essentially have to implement what's really a fairly open-ended problem, you could start from the program I'm showing you, although maybe not the best way to do it. But essentially, you have to start from a blank slate and generate a program that can do this, which is not something you can do in an hour the day before. So start early, and hopefully it'll not be overly painful. So with that in mind, let's look at the naive non-threaded solution. So the main point of this solution is kind of just to do away with all of the overhead that is problem-centric and not related to threads, right? We don't want you banging your head against the wall for hours because you can't figure out the kind of esoteric data structures involved in using the Berkeley sockets DNS lookup functions, right? So I'll take you through that today. Some of this will probably be recast. We're going to give you a little utility library along with this. So some of the stuff I do in my program will probably be recast into easier to use utilities. If you want to write it all from scratch, go for it. You don't have to use anything we're giving you. But you're welcome to use whatever we're giving you. It's given to you with the intention that makes your life at least somewhat easier. So this is mechanics today. It's not really dealing so much directly with the problems inherent to the threaded side of this. It's dealing with everything else so that you don't have to. So all right, well, I'll start by running it once first because that tends to be a good place to start. So like I said, this code will be provided with the rest of the code. I have my program here. It's just written as a single C file. I have a make file, which just handles building, cleaning, etc. There for my benefit more than anything. I have this output file, which actually can be removed. That's from last time I ran it. I have a README, partially because this is on GitHub, and README is necessary for that. It doesn't really say anything other than my name. And then I have this single input file. So if we kind of start by looking at our input file, it is, as we said before, just a big list of domain names. There'll be one per line. My program actually handles them as long as there's some form of white space between them, but you can assume they're one per line. It makes your life easier. Then, if we run the program real quick, so I'll compile it. We now have the actual executable in the folder. I will go ahead and run that. And if I run it just like this, it gives me this nice error message, which we'll go over in a minute, but essentially it's telling me I'm not using it correctly. So I will run it again. I will give it the input file that I want to give it. So I'm going to give it that input file we just looked at. I need to specify some output file. It doesn't matter whether or not it exists. If it exists, it'll overwrite it. But I'll just do output.txt. And now if we run it, it goes through. It prints a bunch of gibberish to the screen. It won't do that by the time I give it to you. This is really bad form. In Unix, it's no news is good news, is the correct philosophy. If you don't have anything to say, don't say anything. So the only thing you really want to print is errors. You don't want to. I wrote this late last night, and this is debugging output that hasn't been correctly removed yet. But the important thing is, we now have this additional output.txt file, and if we look at that, we get output of the form we wanted. It looks just like our input file, only now each domain name is followed by a comma and at least one IP address. Have I lost anyone?
So did you just randomly choose one of the IP addresses for each domain name?
It was not random. I chose the first.
Okay.
But as he points out, a lot of these domain names will yield more than one IP address. Some will only yield one IP address, but many of them will yield more than one. The way the program, we may change this, the way the assignment's written now is that you only have to provide one. If you want to provide more than one, we'll probably just open up that option. To do that, you would just keep adding commas and IP addresses, keeping them one at the line. But my program just grabs the first one. It does, however, find all of them just to prove that I could. Other questions?
Berkeley Sockets, a C++ API.
Berkeley Sockets isn't everything under the Sun API. It's just called Sockets most of the time, right? But there is, it is kind of the most programming languages have a version of Sockets. It's kind of the de facto standard for doing network programming. We actually don't use a lot of like real true socket stuff here. This is more like the Sockets auxiliary functions that do DNS lookups for you, right? It's not like we're actually building sockets or connections. But yeah, Berkeley Sockets dates back to BSD and is now kind of the de facto, all programming languages have a Sockets API. There is C Sockets, which is what we'll be,
I haven't worked with pthread as much. Is that C or is that C++?
Pthread?
Yeah.
So everything we do in this class will be C. Pthread's, again, also a larger concept. You can have pthread implementations in other things.
Right.
But will be all of your code will be C code. Okay. You'll be using the C libraries. You'll be using the C pthread library and the C Sockets library in this case. The Linux C Sockets library really can work this stuff. Other questions? Okay. So let's start looking at the code a little bit. We have a gist of what it does. I will walk you through. We will more or less read that. I don't want to make it too much bigger. My lines are going to start to wrap in awkward ways. So like any good code walk, interrupt me at any time. I'm happy to stop. Don't necessarily worry about understanding exactly what each line's doing, more get a gist of what's going on here. The reason we're providing this to you, like I said, is because we don't want you guys to get tied up in the basic mechanics of making this work. We want you to get tied up in the basic mechanics of making threads work, which is plenty to get tied up in by itself. So we come through here, you have your standard set of include files. These are basically just standard C library files. These are include files related to the socket stuff that I end up using. I do some pound defines. This is just, eventually, this will turn off all that ugly output. It doesn't right now. This is just the minimum number of arguments, which as it's written right now is 3. In C, you always have to have at least one argument. It's the name of the program that you specify on the command line. So my min is 3 arguments because I need the name of the program, the name of the input file, and the name of the output file. That'll probably change some too. To make this a nice, pretty Unix program, the standard would be, if I didn't specify an output file, it should just assume a default name, or I should be able to put things like dashes here to get it to use standard in and standard out if I want to do that. So I'll clean this up a little bit, but as it's written right now, it needs at least 3 arguments. If it doesn't, it prints that error message at the beginning that you guys saw when I ran it the first time. I specify essentially a buffer size. There's some string processing involved here. We're both reading strings out of files and writing strings back to the files or go. At some point, I'm going to need to store those strings somewhere. That's what this buffer's for. I'm saying none of my lines are going to be greater than 1025 characters. If you're using every IP address, this might become problematic. For one IP address, you're never going to exceed this. And then I have an input format string. When I read it from my file, I use an fscanf function, which we'll get to here in a minute. But essentially, it takes a format string of the rest form of the rest of the C standard library, where this percent says this is a format string, the s says I'm looking for a string, and the 1024 says don't give me more than 1024 characters. If it's a string longer than 1024 concatenated at that point, I just want the first 1024. This is here to prevent buffer overflows. Essentially, it's one less than the buffer size to save room for a null terminator, which I think is necessary given the way this, that sometimes the null terminator is included, but in this format string it's not. So you need to make sure you decrement by one. Questions on what happens before any of the program happens? All right. So we get done with the main. It's, like I said, a fairly naive implementation right now. It's all just in main. There's no functions it calls. So we kind of start walking through it. In pure C, C99 stuff relaxes this limit, but technically you're only allowed to declare your variables at the start of a function. You can't declare them arbitrarily throughout. So I start by declaring all the variables I'm going to use local to this function. That includes 2 file pointers, one for my input file, one for my output file. it includes this, like we talked about before, it includes this buffer that I can essentially, I'm using to store host names. It includes these series of structs. These all deal with the DNS lookup itself. This is related to the socket stuff again. We'll probably give you a function that bypasses a lot of the need to even copy and paste stuff out of here, but this deals with the DNS lookup stuff. These here, essentially, when you look up an IP address, it gets returned to you as a number, not as a string. It doesn't make this nice dot, dot, dot number format that you're seeing here. It's literally a binary number. It would just be represented as such. It's an integer. Or depending on the type of address, something like that. But essentially, as part of this process, not only do I have to look up the computer-readable value of this IP address, I want to convert it to a human-readable string in the fairly standard number dot number dot number dot number IPv4 format that you guys are probably used to seeing. So that's what these deal with here. They essentially handle places for me to store the string version of the IP address, and then there's just a little error counter. My code's written to at least potentially handle IPv6 addresses right now. Yours doesn't have to be. It doesn't really come into play. I didn't get any back when I did the lookup as is. But that's part of the reason there's some IPv6 specific stuff in there too. So then we go through. First thing I do is check my arguments. This is something you always want to do, especially if you have arguments that could break your program. Like I said, this will probably get more robust right now. If it has less than 3 arguments, it just exits and tells you you're not using it correctly. The cleaner way to do it would be, if it only gets 2 arguments, to assume that it just uses a default output file name and then to add some extra processing to let you use standard in or standard out. But right now it just checks, it kicks you out if you don't have the relevant arguments. It then opens up the files that we need. So first it goes and it opens up our input file, which is pulling from the argument we passed in. It's opening it in a read-only mode. There's no reason you need to write to your input file, so don't open it in a mode where you could write to it. Just good practice. The idea of minimum privilege, never give yourself the ability to do more than what you absolutely have to do. Then we get into, like all system calls like this, have the ability to essentially pass back error information if something goes wrong. You absolutely need to be checking and catching that. In this case, the fopen command will return a null pointer if something goes wrong, and then I'll print out this error here. PR is a handy little function that'll both print the message I specify here, as well as when this actually generates an error, it saves some error state in the system. And by using PERROR, I can not only print my own error message, but I can also kind of print the error message that's actually being generated, which can give me some enlightenment. This comes in handy in a situation like this, where maybe I give it, as we already saw, if I don't give it enough arguments, it gives me that message. But if I give it enough arguments, but just make them bogus file names, it hits that error message we're looking at right now, where it essentially prints my line, and then it gives me the error that I've actually encountered, which is there is no file by this name. So at the very least, catch your errors and exit. That's kind of like the bare minimum, right? Because it keeps you from breaking anything. But to really make your life useful, give yourself as much reasonable information as you really can. So we do that twice, once for the input file, we do it once for the output file. The output file's opened in write mode, obviously. This is actually overwrite mode, so if the file already exists, it essentially erases it and writes over it again. That's fine for the purposes of this assignment. Same idea, if something goes wrong, it prints an error. People with me still? Questions? Okay. So then we come down here to the actual loop that makes up the bulk of the program, which, because it's just a single-threaded program, is fairly naive. I have this top-level while loop. What it does is it grabs the strings out of my input file, one string at a time. It processes each string, writes it to the output file, and then proceeds to the next string. Again, I'm using fscanf to actually read these strings. Fscanf is just like fprintf, but in the opposite direction. It looks for some format string and then returns the first item that satisfies that string. That format string is the one we looked up at the top. It's the %1024s, so it's looking for strings, and it's going to concatenate them to no more than 1024. There's other ways to do this. You could take advantage of the fact that you're told each of these is on its own line and use like a read line function. Whatever you do, make sure it's buffer overflow safe. This is the real place you got to be really careful about it. If you're reading lines, don't just read an arbitrary. Don't read to an end line. You have to at least specify some maximum number. But there are protected line read formats to do that. The advantage to doing it the fscanf way, as opposed to reading lines, so reading lines is a little bit extra, avoids this whole format, or a little bit easier, it avoids this whole format string issue. The The advantage to mine is it'll work even if they're not all in the same line. If you just give me a file of domain name separated by space or separated by tabs, as long as there's white space between them, my program will work. Not a requirement, but if you have opportunities to make things easily more robust, it's generally best to do so. The good philosophy is, when you're writing programs that deal with standardized formats on the input and output, is you want to be as generous as possible when you're accepting input, and you want to be as strict as possible when you're generating output. So you'll read almost anything someone can give you, but you'll generate exactly what you say you're going to generate. And then everyone plays nicely, and the world works through. So we have this while loop. It goes through. The greater than zero is essentially just a test. When it hits the end of file, when it gets to the end of file, fscanf is going to return zero, essentially. It always is going to return the number of strings it read, which will be one, until it gets to the end of file, and then it won't read any strings. It'll return to zero. That'll break the while loop. We've read the file. We're done. So it's kind of typical of C. People used to languages may not like it, but this one line here essentially handles our entire traversal and reading of the file in one fell swoop. People okay with that? So then we come down into here. This is just some of that debug output, which will be nicely cleaned up later. It just prints out the host name that it reads. We get down into here, and this whole section here is basically all of the sockets code that deals with the actual DNS lookup itself. We do it via this get address info function, which returns to us, we pass it the host name we're looking up, so we pass it the string reflecting some host name. You can potentially pass it some additional information that'll limit the scope of its lookup. You can say only look up on these servers, only look up this type of server. Passing in nulls kind of just gives it the most general case you can. And then it returns to you a pointer to a linked list of results. Because there can be more than one IP address, you can't have it, you kind of have to have a linked list as your return type here, because that's the cleanest way to handle an arbitrary number of return values. So my program handles this linked list. It is a linked list. If you're only pulling the first IP address, you could technically just ever, I mean, you can never go past, you'd never need to traverse the linked list, right? You just look at your head node. Your head node is going to have at least one IP address in it. If that's all you need, you're good. My code actually goes through the linked list, again, kind of just because I wanted to make sure I knew how it worked. But that may not be necessary to you. More importantly, this will probably be abstracted from you altogether. I will write a utility function that you pass a host name to, and you either get back a single result, or maybe I'll pass you back a linked list of results, but it'll just be results already of that form. You don't have to deal with all of this code to actually extract that from this somewhat complex structure. Sockets is great because it's super generalized. We use it for basically everything, IPv4, IPv6. You can use it for protocols that aren't even standard internet protocols. The downside to this is all of the data structures it uses have to kind of be, they're all general purpose. They can be used for multiple things, which means you have to cast them to whatever you think they need to be in. And it turns into a whole bunch of code to essentially extract that IP address from this linked list to pass back to me. So I'll touch on some of this a little bit. Don't worry if you don't understand this. One, it'll be abstracted from you. Two, if you want to understand it, you can plow through the man pages. It's complicated by nature of the way that, by nature of the fact that it does everything. So it's always a trade-off. The more you do, the more complicated things get. But essentially the way it works is we call this get address info function. It's returning this linked list. It could also return an error. That's what's going on here. If it returns an error, I'm going to print an error. It has its own specific clean print error. So this basically gives me a pretty string describing whatever error occurred. If I, my function and your programs too are only going to work if you're connected to the internet. If I turn off my wireless connection and run this, I get an error message generated right here, because it can't perform the lookup, it has no internet connection. Something to think about, if you hit an error message that reflects it not being able to look something up, you might want to make sure you have an internet connection as a prerequisite for running this. Then we go through, and this is actually our linked list traversal, is what happens right here. So again, if you only wanted to read your head result, you could essentially remove this for loop and just read the first item. This for loop traverses the linked list and reads each of them, and it does that by, so this is a pointer to the head node of the linked list. I also have an additional variable that represents my current node, results my current node, head results my head node. The initialization condition is setting my current node to my head node. This is pretty standard powerful linked list traversal. I continue until my current node equals null, so until I get to that last pointer on the linked list. And each iteration, I'm going to update my current node to be equal to the node that node points to. So standard linked list traversal, again, C practice, it all winds up in one line of for loop. But that's all it's doing. for each node, I basically go through, there's a bunch of magic that happens here that deals with recasting this smorgasbord of data structures to essentially turn it into an IPv4 address that you can read as a string down there. It actually will, like I said, it'll handle IPv6 addresses, or at least detect IPv6 addresses, which is what this else case here is handling. It goes through, it looks at the family, this is the IPv4, this is telling me that node is for an IPv4 address. If so, it goes through the decoding of the IPv4 address into a human readable string. It then saves that to this IP string variable. If not, it assumes it's an IPv6 address, and then I could put the equivalent of this code here that decodes an IPv6 address. I haven't done that. This is what kind of actually matters. When we're on the first node, so when our node equals the head node, it saves that IP string that we're actually regenerating each time to this first IP string variable. So this is where I actually pull out the first IP string, which is all I use. Again, this is if you really only wanted the first one, you wouldn't do this in the first place. You would just read the head node. This is accomplishing the same thing. I just wanted to make sure I could read all of them. So again, if this is confusing, great, it is confusing. It took me like an hour I use sockets a lot, and it always takes me an hour of looking at the man pages to kind of compare all of the intricate data structures and find out exactly what I have to test what. Sockets are great, but they're not simple. You get down to here, we have in this first IP string, we have an IP string, and now we're going to write it to our output file. So just like scanf, we're using fprintf now. You probably used this before with standard error, standard out. You can also pass it a file pointer to an actual file, not to just the standard files. We're going to give it a string of the format string, comma, string, new line. The first string is going to be our host name, which we extracted away at the top of this loop. The second string is going to be that first IP address, which we saved back here. And you're going to wind up with an output that looks like that. We then have to basically free that linked list to pass back to us. It generated the linked list. You have to free it. You don't do this. So again, this is just when you look up the man page for that function that gave you the linked list, it also tells you about this function that you have to use to free the linked list. So,
a quick question I'm noticing here on your string copy, mm-hmm. Giving the size of that what your destination is, right? Is it a void buffer overflow potentially? In both cases, is your IPv4 string, is that provided to you as a dynamically allocated string, so it could be larger than your destination buffers?
No, all of these are.
Your destination is listed first.
So
right?
This one's correct. Okay. Yeah, it's destination
right.
Source.
Uh-huh.
So this one's correct. It should be size of the destination.
Yeah, that's what I was asking. So you're doing that to make sure you don't overflow.
Right. This is to prevent overflow.
Potentially, you're getting something.
That's why this is why string in copy,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And gives you this
yeah.
extra option. I just noticed this one.
This one's correct as well. Yeah.
Yep, they're both good.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm passing it the size of essentially this first buffer. This only works if they're statically allocated.
Uh-huh.
If it was dynamically allocated, you can't call size of on it because
yeah.
size of happens before compile time.
Sure.
So it can only resolve the size of its dynamic allocated. But yeah,
yeah.
These are buffer. I mean,
cool.
Just good practice. You're probably not that much of a risk of a buffer overflow here because I'm going to like inject code into the library functions that you were, but good practice, right? Always limit to the size of the output buffer. Other questions? Anyway, we get down here to the end, we free our linked list, and we're at the end of our while loop. And now we either go to the next line, or that last test fails, we're at the end of our file, and we're done. Kind of makes sense? So the only thing that would change if I actually wanted to write all of these out, I would do away with this concept of keeping track of the first one. I would essentially have to separate my fprintf statement into two halves. One half that writes the host name, and then another half that runs each time in the loop that just keeps appending these comma IP address onto it. And then I could make a version that writes all of it. I will probably give you guys a function that you pass a host name to and that you get back a single IP address from. And maybe I'll also give you a function you pass a host name to and that you get back a linked list from. I could just give you the latter function, but then you all have to at least be able to extract one item from the linked list. We'll see. We'll see how generous I'm feeling. But there will be some utility functions so even if I didn't give you the utility functions, you could just copy this one block of code and plug it into the relevant portion of your program. But to save you the trouble of doing that, I'll probably write you a little utility function that does what we just talked about here. Again, it's not a network programming class. If it were, I'd make you write this part, but the point is not so you can dive into the intricacies of using the sockets library in an IPv6 primitive way. The point is to make sure you can do threads. So then we finish the loop altogether. We've written all the things to the output file. We come down here. We have to close both our input files and our output files. Again, this is cleanup. And we return an exit success. And we're done. We've solved the problem. So your guys' goal is now to take this concept and thread it, like we talked about before. One of the big things you're going to have to watch out for in this program is keeping an eye on your memory management. You don't want to leak memory. The write-up talks about this a little bit. It's not installed on your VM by default, but you can install it easily. Matter of fact, I probably need to install it now because I didn't even test this on my VM. So Valgrind, if you've never used it before, is installed. Okay. So it should already be installed on your VM, so if you find that's not true, let me know. But Valgrind is a program that essentially does a whole bunch of things, but one of the things it does nicely is it'll check your code for memory leaks while it runs. So if I want to make sure my code doesn't have any memory leaks, I go ahead and call Valgrind, call the name of my program. I have to give it the same input and output file that I would normally give it. And it goes, your program runs a lot more slowly because Valgrind basically replaces a bunch of the memory management in it. And then you get down here at the bottom and you get this nice set of information where the important line is, the important line is that it has zero errors from zero contexts and essentially no leaks. That might be a lie. I wonder if I put an error in this. I actually might be leaking a little bit of information. But I shouldn't be. I will check that. But essentially, you can. The program write-up talks about it a little bit. You'll want to use Valgrind. We'll use it during the grading session. And you should end up in a situation where, essentially, you definitely don't lose any data directly. Some of this indirect loss stuff you can always prevent. Sometimes it has to do with the libraries you're calling. But you definitely should not be leaking any memory directly. This is a little bit disturbing. These should match. If I have 226 Alex, I should have 226 freeze, which is why I wonder if I maybe introduced a little bug. I'll look at that. But in a nice world, you'll get 226 Alex, 226 freeze, and I'll print this message under it that says no leaks possible.
Is that count there, the number of allocations and freeze, is that directly ones you allocated?
No,
does that include library
total
allocations?
That's anything that got called from the
moment all the way down.
So I don't use malloc at all.
Yeah.
So all of these are somebody else.
Yeah. Okay.
And in fact, they're in the generation of linked list. I'll fix my code and figure out why that is. But Valgrind's a good tool for kind of telling you this. It doesn't have any super obvious errors. If you have super obvious errors, it'll actually give you the line numbers that you should go back and look at. So if there is an error in there, it's a subtle one. I'll have to go parse it out. Questions on kind of what this program does or what you're going to have to do with it? We have a few minutes, so I will get into a little bit of, we'll start to talk about it a little more. So that's how you solve it. And how do you solve it with threads becomes the question. So a couple things you have to think about when you're dealing with threads is it's a lot harder to debug multi-threaded programs for one. You can no longer have such a good idea of exactly where in the program code you are because you have a whole bunch of things executing in parallel. And if an error only occurs on one of those things, then it becomes a lot more difficult to kind of track down what's happening. So I'll send you some links on some kind of techniques that you can help with this a little bit. At the end of the day, it's just harder to debug multi-threaded programs than to debug not multi-threaded programs. And it's just something you kind of have to learn to deal with. There's no magic bullet to make the extra complexity go away. If anyone knows of one, let me know. But there's one. So, like we said, the main crux is, again, maybe we should, I think Dirk, or not Dirk, wow, that was the last class. I think Rich just got into what threads are in class today, yeah, or in class yesterday?
A little bit.
So you'll have more on threads. You haven't done mutexes or semaphores yet, right? Great. So all of the things you need for this assignment, you haven't really touched on the lecture yet. But that's what you'll be hitting them this Thursday and next Tuesday is the plan. You can stick his lecture schedule. So to start out, does anyone know what the difference between threads and processes is? Just maybe some overhead.
That is shared memory space.
Okay. Which has a shared memory space?
Threads have shared.
Okay.
Processes have their own.
Yep. That's essentially the crux of it. So In 2400, we dealt with a program, in 2400, we dealt with a program that dealt with multiple processes. We wrote a little shell interpreter that dispatched all these processes and then eventually monitored them, waited them in, so on and so forth. Processes are an older concept in operating systems. We've had processes since we've kind of had, more or less, since the third or fourth operating system ever. And the concept of process is great. You can do a lot of things with it. It isolates. So whenever you run a program, you generate a process. A process is essentially an instance of a running program. And you can write a program that runs as multiple processes that then communicate with each other. And that's the way we used to do it. Threads are a newer concept on the scene. So you could write this as a multi-process problem instead of a multi-thread problem. Now, we use threads over processes in certain situations for a couple of reasons. Processes, as you said, have no shared memory space, which really has two side effects. One, inter-process communication is more complicated than inter-thread communication. They're separate processes. Processes are purposely isolated. That's part of the process model. So to communicate between processes, you have to go through some standardized interface. Sometimes this is a really good thing. There's a lot of people that don't like multi-threaded programming because it allows you to bypass interfaces. And there's a school of thought that says bypassing interfaces is just a bad idea. It allows you to break down restrictions that otherwise keep you honest and ensure everything works. So you can take that as a good or bad thing. Processes, you have to go through some standard interface. You either have to use sockets themselves to communicate. You've got to like use files. There's other inter-process communication techniques. But you have to come up with some way for this process to communicate. It introduces overhead. It can be complicated. In addition, processes are not lightweight. When you go to spawn a process, it copies the entire memory space. Creating 100 processes takes up a lot more of your system resources than creating 100 threads. So processes worked for a while, but we got to the point where people said there are classes of problems where we don't need full-blown multi-processes. I mean, it's too much overhead. But it would be nice to be able to do multiple things at once. So we introduced the idea of threads, where essentially a thread's a lightweight process. Threads are like processes, only they share memory space, and they share memory space with their parent instead of having their own. So this means no longer do you have to communicate through some standard interface, you will have a bunch of shared variables that you can now essentially communicate through. Also, you don't have to introduce all of the overhead associated with copying your entire memory space like you do for a process. So it's not like threads are always better, it's not like processes are always better, and there are people that will fight one way or another, but there's a time and a place for each. We're using threads. This assignment suits itself well to threads because they're all kind of doing the same thing. There's no real argument for why you might need to separate them. What they're doing is fairly well defined, so on and so forth. But by having that shared memory space, it introduces its own set of complexities. It introduces this shared resource problem. If you spawn all your threads after you open your files, those open file handles are going to be available in every thread. If you have multiple threads, try to write to the same file handle at once, which they could do. You're going to, like we said before, wind up with some kind of bogus output information. So the crux with having threads becomes a matter of protecting resources. And the way we do that is through things called semaphores in general, also sometimes called a mutex. A mutex is really, people define these things different ways, which is not great. But often a mutex is a subset of a semaphore, where essentially what a mutex and a semaphore are, what mutexes or semaphores are means for you to control access to some resource. Where if you have a semaphore, it's kind of like if you have a flag you pass around. So you're like at a meeting, you don't have everyone to talk at the same time. So you have some flag that you pass around the meeting, and only the person holding the flag can actually talk at that given time. That's kind of the idea behind semaphores, where the process is the same. You can define a semaphore that all of these threads share. You can say that this is going to be the semaphore that protects the queue. And before you can use the queue, you have to check out a copy of the semaphore. Now, there's only maybe one copy of the semaphore, and that's where some people call mutexes, that only semaphores only have one copy, sometimes we call mutexes, but same concept. You could have three copies of the semaphore. Maybe we have three queues, so we can check out up to three copies at the same time. But for our purpose, we have one queue, we have one copy of the semaphore. I'm gonna go to try, if I wanna use the queue, first I have to check out the queue semaphore. If I go to do that, if the semaphore is available, no one else has checked it out, I'll get handed it. That's my signal that it's safe for me to perform operations on the queue. When I'm done performing operations, I will check my semaphore back in, someone else can come along and use it. If I go to check out the semaphore when someone else already has it checked out, I'm gonna essentially either get an error message back saying that you can't check it out right now, or you can generally put it in a mode where I just wait. It adds me to a queue, I wait and do nothing until that semaphore becomes available, at which point I did it, I then go do my operations. So this is a great way to protect a common resource like this, but it has pitfalls. If you check out a semaphore and never check it back in, you're essentially going to screw everyone out, and your program's never going to finish. You will never be able to continue past that point. So semaphores are necessary to protect resources, but by introducing semaphores, we can also introduce deadlock, where there are situations you can get into where if you're not careful about making sure you always get rid of the semaphore as soon as you can, you always do what you need to do and then pass it back, your program will never end. You'll hit a situation where everyone has all the resources checked out. There's a lot of formal, so this problem is not quite as, deadlock's not, I hesitate to say that, but this is not a problem that's necessarily gonna be one of having a, I don't know if deadlock's gonna be that big of a deal for you as long as you guys are somewhat careful about always returning your semaphores. There are cases where you can have, so instead of one queue, say we had like seven queues, and for some reason, I can't write to the first queue until I write to the, I can't write to the second queue until I write to the first queue, and I can't write to the third until I write to the second queue, so on and so forth. In situations like that, where you have these resources with interdependencies and you're using semaphores, it's much easier to get into deadlock situations where even if you're returning your semaphore when you're done, there could occur a situation where if the last guy's waiting on the first semaphore, but he's still in order, he's still holding open the last semaphore, then you can essentially create this circular dependency that'll never get freed and it's a deadlock condition that your program will never go past. Those can be really hard to troubleshoot. Because we don't really have interdependencies between our resources here, you're gonna have less of an issue with that, but you have to start thinking about all of these things when we get into the thread land, and it does get more complicated. If making this a multi-threaded program were easy, I wouldn't have just given you essentially a non-threaded solution, right? The reason we can give you a non-threaded solution is because making it threaded is non-trivial. And the best way to start is probably not to just take my code and start threading it. The best way to start is probably from scratch, because a multi-threaded program will look different enough in structure that you might find yourself spending more work trying to morph code than just writing the code from scratch. We'll provide this to you. It's a good reference. If you want to morph it, great. But like I said, you may have better luck kind of going to it as an example and writing your multi-threaded version from scratch. We will give you a queue. We will give you, like I said, a function that handles some of the DNS lookup itself. We will give you pointers to references on how to use pthreads, so on and so forth. You'll have to do some of that reading on your own.
What would be permitted to use any existing multi-threaded, I mean, thread-safe data structures, or would you have to write our own if we want to do that?
I'm going to say no, because part of the point is this queue is not thread-safe. Which is
right.
I mean, if you have a thread-safe queue, it's not your problem anymore, right?
Okay.
Someone's already solved it for you.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say you could write your own. Yeah. You either have to write your own thread-safe queue, which you've proved to me you know you have to do it, or you have to use our queue, which isn't thread-safe, which means you then have to protect the queue on your own. The point of this assignment is not to show you can use fancy libraries and solve these problems for you. Other questions? So we'll go over some more of the pitfalls next week. Actually, you guys had a couple of the lectures. Something to start kicking around in your brain. This will come out on Monday. Start on it before recitation next week. I know that's only 2 days. You don't need to finish it for recitation next week, but do take a look at it. Start getting a feel for what it is. Come with your questions next week. If you have any questions you want off camera, we can do them now. And that's all we got. Thanks a lot.